the end of the day, music is an industry, and when you're hiring people and you're paying people and you know you're going on the road and you're selling tickets, you know, you do have to think about those bottom lines sometimes, and you do have to think about why people are invested in you and maybe what their angle is, what their end goal is. And I didn't realize that when I was younger. That's the thing with money, right? Is you can say, man, I really want to make 100K this year. But then when you have that 100K, you're like, man, it would have been a lot cooler if I would have made a quarter of a mil, right? Whatever it is. So if your version of success is money, I think you already have a really, really big problem. If your version of success is finding fulfillment within your work and, you know, contributing a greater good, follow that, then I think it's well-intentioned.
So we are here in the green room of the Rock and Roll Hotel in the promised land of DC.
The promised land of DC.
We're here with Greyson Chance, who is a musical artist, also my brother-in-law, and he's in town for a show, and he's got a real interesting journey so far, and just wanted to tap into it. It involves a lot of growth, a lot of leadership and influence and resilience, and excited to hear some more about it. But Greyson, if you just want to kick us off with kind of the intro story of how you got to where you are, and then we'll dive into it.
Yeah, of course. Well, we said, okay, I'm going to try to keep this as brief as possible because it is a really long story. But, you know, as you know now, I started when I was 12 years old based off a viral video. And at the time, this was in 2010. So this was kind of on the eve of YouTube really kind of having the impact as a platform as it does now, right? It was still sort of in the beginning stages, and we posted up a video online. It went viral really overnight, and
What was the video?
It was me singing Lady Gaga's Paparazzi at a talent show in Oklahoma City, and it went viral overnight, and that led me to a record deal, which I signed when I was 12 years old, and it really led me into a career. It led me to learning what it meant to be an artist and a songwriter, and led me to the life I have now. However, you know, I was signed to that record label for 4 years. And was sort of thrust into the music industry. And after that period of having a lot of success, there was a down period, and that's when I got dropped by my label, my management, my agent, everybody left. So I had to quickly transition when I was 16 years old to figure out what I was gonna do in the meantime.
Yeah. Man, what was that like getting dropped?
Yeah.
Because you were on tour, you were touring all over the country, right? And then international tours.
All over the world, yeah.
And then just, it was over.
Yeah.
What was that like?
It was extremely difficult. I think looking back at it, it was probably the most difficult time of my life that I know now to date, because it taught me a few lessons. And I think the first lesson was is you can never be sure of anything. You always have to stay sharp and always have to, you know, kind of look around at what's going on and make sure that you're betting on things that are good risk and that are good bets. And I think what it also told me is that trust is a very finite thing sometimes, especially in the music industry. And you know, I think there's still a lot of healing that's coming from that, of me learning to trust people, because a lot of people who said that they were going to be around with me and for me for the length of my career, they left the second that the money wasn't coming in anymore.
Man.
And that was a hard thing to learn at a young age.
Yeah, that's pretty brutal.
Mm-hmm.
So I love this part of your story, because being in the entrepreneurial realm, you see so many people take big risks, and a lot of times they don't pan out. But that's going to happen regardless, right? So I think being successful is about being resilient a lot of the time. So when you got dropped, what happened next? Like how much time occurred before you decided to go after it again?
Yeah. Well, it was like a 4-year period. So I was dropped when I was 16, and for 2 years I kept on working in music. I was writing a lot. I was trying to find a new team. And I think, you know, going back to what I, you know, mentioned previously, that's where I started to notice, you know, sort of the trust issues that I was going through, and also just learning the business side of things. As I was getting older, I was starting to see how things were operating in a true sense. And maybe I didn't know that when I was younger. I was a bit protected from it.
What do you mean by true sense?
You know, I think you kind of start to see, you know, just at the end of the day, music is an industry. And when you're hiring people and you're paying people and, you know, you're going on the road and you're selling tickets, you know, you do have to think about those bottom lines sometimes. And you do have to think about why people are invested in you, and maybe what their angle is, what their end goal is. And I didn't realize that when I was younger. So I think after getting dropped, I sort of had this sense of clarity. And in many ways, it kind of fueled my creativity in a sort of ironic, like hypocritical sense. As I was beginning to see the industry more clearly, I think I started to realize how beautiful music was inside it, and how interesting and fun this whole thing was of being able to take this creative spear and have this business side. But I spent 2 years writing. It wasn't going so well. I wasn't too happy with the work that I was making. And when I turned 18, I really thought that was just it for me in music. I didn't think that I was going to have a successful story moving forward. And so I decided to leave LA, and I decided to go to college. And I really thought that I was never going to go back. And I thought that all of this, you know, sort of learned experience that I had from the industry, I remember taking it away and saying, this is going to be very helpful for me in another career path. But the downside of it is that it led me away to led me away from music.
Did you know what that other career path was at the time?
At the time, I thought I was going to go to law school and be a lawyer. I was pretty devoted to that. And I was, at the time, very dead set on, this new journey in life. And it felt right, and it felt genuine at first. But then that sort of changed when I was in school.
Yeah. So you had this craft that you had been honing in on, mm-hmm. even before the viral video, right? Because mm-hmm. you were playing piano yeah. prior to that. So you'd been building this craft. You said that you went viral at 12. So, you know, 5, maybe 10 years of playing piano even beforehand. And you decided to put this all on the back burner, mm-hmm. or maybe even done with it completely, mm-hmm. to pursue mm-hmm. school. Mm-hmm. Okay, so how long were you pursuing school for before yeah. things started to change again?
I was in university for 2 years, and the first year that I was in school, I didn't like touch a piano at all. You know, I maybe like every so often would, you know, hit on the keys or try to write something, but I...
Intentionally, or like because you were done with it, or you just didn't have time?
I think intentionally. I think I was, you know, so sort of scarred by some of my experiences, and I wanted to stay very, very far away from it as far as I could. And so it wasn't until really my second year of school that I was able to kind of take a breath and go back to the keyboard or go back to the piano and sort of just talk honestly for the first time with the lyrics and what I wanted to say and what I wanted to do. And then that led me to writing like 6 or 7 songs, which kind of got circulated around town. And then I got a record deal offered to me in January of 2018. And I told them, I said, I need 6 months to finish my semester, and I'll give you a decision in May. And those 6 months were probably the most reflective I've had in my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. What did a lot of soul searching.
Just deciding which way to go or what?
I think deciding which way to go, also being able to understand that, you know, I learned so much from 12 to 18. I had to see so many, I got to experience so many amazing things, but I also had to see a lot of people do bad by me. A lot of people be more influenced by money than they are by creativity. A lot of people, as we talked about, trust issues, not saying the truth all the time when they're at the table talking about business or saying what they know that I might have wanted to hear. And so what I had to think about is I had to think about whether I was passionate enough about the music, enough to have that strength to go into the circus again and to go into the arena again. And truly at the core of it, and I think this applies to everything, not just music, you know, business dealings are hard, right? It's tricky when you're talking about money and you're talking about, you know, how things are going to pan out, X, Y, Z. But if you're passionate enough about why you're doing it and why you have to sit at that table every day and look through your spreadsheets and do all these sorts of things, then you're able to get through and you're able to fuel yourself through it. And right now, you know my life, you know, better than a lot of people. We're traveling a lot. There's a lot of moving pieces. But I'm finding myself with a much larger stamina now and a much bigger tolerance to kind of take a breath and take a step back because I am so fueled by the music.
Yeah.
And so when I made that decision, I said, do you think that you can be strong enough? And I said, I really do this time around.
And that was pretty risky. Mm-hmm. You know, you didn't mention the school, but it was University of Tulsa.
Tulsa, yeah, right? Rain came.
Yeah. Which is a good school, right?
A hard school to get into, yeah.
And leaving a school you were already in and you were on a great track, mm-hmm. I'm sure you were probably a straight A student. Mm-hmm.
I was. Yeah. I had one B. Yeah. And I really hate that professor so much. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. All right, so that was a risk that you took to leave a safe path that would have, without a doubt, led you to a successful career, mm-hmm. you know, in the legal realm. What were you betting on? Like, were you betting on yourself? Mm-hmm. Was it this newfound passion? Mm-hmm. You know, there are people out there that want to take the risk but haven't yet or can't. Mm-hmm. Like, what would you say to them?
I think life is too short to not do it. I think if I've learned anything from music and just my time is that, you know, and we hear this a lot now, and I'm glad that we hear this a lot now, but I'll reinforce it. You learn so much from failure. That's the first thing. So this idea of if you're about to take the risk and you're thinking, well, what if it doesn't pan out? In a way, embrace that, because I think you learn so much about yourself and you learn so much about your passions when you're at bottom and you don't have anywhere to go. And in many ways, that can be very encouraging and very fulfilling. And I think for me, I took the risk because I was passionate about it. And I think that's what's so inspiring about what I see with, you know, a lot of the brands that you even work with or the people that you work with a lot. I think there are so many people that do what they do not because of money or not because they're trying to reach an end goal, but because they're really passionate about the work. And those are the types of people that I want to surround myself with.
Yeah.
I got unlucky when I was younger and had to deal with some bullshit, right? That's okay. That happens. And that is what it is. But when you find those people that take the risk because it's passion force, that's so inspiring to me. Yeah. And that's really what it was for me last year, and that's what Portraits was, my album. It was a risk, but at the same time, I didn't care about what the outcome was. I was like, I'm so pumped to be doing this. I'm so glad to write this record. And it's panned out so far.
Yeah. I think that's pretty insightful,
yeah.
Because I'm sure there are people that are weighing out whether or not they should mm-hmm. take the risk, take the jump, but you felt so passionately about mm-hmm. it that you didn't even care about mm-hmm. the end result. And maybe that's an indicator for mm-hmm. some people, yeah. Like, do you still care? And if mm-hmm. you do, maybe you aren't as passionate about it as you think.
Sure.
So, okay. So, and one thing that you said was you're conscious now mm-hmm. of who you surround yourself mm-hmm. with. It sounds like you grew from the experience mm-hmm. of being dropped, mm-hmm. right? And so through this journey of growth, and you mentioned you're surrounding yourself with other people. What are some other like habits or practices that you have in place just to continue growing as an individual and as an artist?
Meditation in any way that you can find it, whether that's something that you do in a religious sense, whether that's something you do. I like to run. And a lot of people are, when I say I meditate, people are like, oh, so like, you know, you sit and you do the thing. I'm like, yeah, sometimes I'll, you know, take some breaths, but when I run, that's my meditation, because I can really cycle through my thoughts. Or even just like taking a walk by yourself for 15, 20 minutes. I think alone time to really just have your thoughts and to really kind of collect things. I think if you take that time daily, 20, 30 minutes, it will, the impact that will have on your life, I think, is really important. And I would also say too, just, it sounds cheesy, but just trying to really focus on positivity rather than your regrets or your mistakes of the day. Mm. Going to bed every night and trying to think about something good that happened.
Yeah, yeah.
That's something I struggle with all the time, but it really, really helps. And yeah, surrounding yourself with people that you trust and with people that you know are good intentioned.
For sure. Mm-hmm. And you read a lot.
I do read a lot. Yeah. I could read more. Everybody could read more. But yeah, I do read a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. That's awesome. So for people out there who are entrepreneurs or maybe they're musicians like yourself and they want to sort of break through to that next level, but they feel maybe trapped or maybe they've even been rejected in a sense, like you've dealt with that being dropped from the label. You know, what's one piece of advice that you would give to somebody in those shoes?
I think the most important thing to do is define your version of success. You know, think about what's going to make you happy at the end of the day. And I, you know, this might be the hippie musician in me, but if that's money, get out, drop it. Cause you're never going to reach a happy place with that. Cause you can always have more. Mm-hmm. That's the thing with money, right? Is you can say, man, I really want to make 100K this year. But then when you have that 100K, you're like, man, it would have been a lot cooler if I would have made 250,000, right? Whatever it is. So if your version of success is money, I think you already have a really, really big problem. If your version of success is finding fulfillment within your work and, you know, contributing a greater good, follow that, then I think it's well-intentioned. I think the second thing is just organization too. You know, how many times that you and I talk about people trying to do too much, you know, just have all these tasks and all these sorts of things, when at the end of the day, if they would just have a clear focus for their brand or for their music or for whatever it would be, and to just follow that rather than trying to do 100 things, one thing really good. Yeah. I think that's important. And then my third thing, let me think here. I'll stick with those two.
Okay.
For musicians, it's a lot more tricky because at the end of the day, like, I can sit here and tell you everything that was a good step for me within my path as a musician, but that could be completely different for someone else, depending on their music or whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah.
If you catch me in some interviews and they go, what would you tell young and aspiring musicians? And some days, depending on how I'm feeling, I'll tell them to not do it.
Right.
Bunch of people roll their eyes at me. But, you know, I think, just focus on your level of success. Stay organized and stay focused.
Okay. Love that, man. That's super insightful. Last question. Mm-hmm. Do you ever have days where you wake up, especially because you're on tour, you've got a ton of U.S. dates, you just came off of an Asia and Europe tour, where it was go, go, go. Do you ever have days where you wake up and just don't feel like performing?
Always, yeah.
Well, what do you do?
You have to stay still with yourself. And I think I've learned this from a lot of artists that I've talked to, and, you know, just a lot of road junkies too, people who kind of live out on the road. You have to remember that when you are an artist and when you are a performer, you're a servant to the people that come to buy a ticket. I feel like it's my job to get up on stage from 8 o'clock to 9:30 every night and to serve as a sense of escape for people. I want people to come to my show and forget about the things they have to do and the problems that are around, and I want them to just feel the music and focus in on that. So whenever I'm feeling on days where I'm like, oh, I feel weak and I don't want to get up and play, I kind of am a little tough love on myself, and I'm like, okay, go cry about it for a second, but realize that there's a lot of people that need you tonight from 8 o'clock to 9:30. They need that sense of release. So get over yourself, essentially.
Yeah.
And usually by the end of the show, I feel a lot better.
Right.
But it's just getting to stage time. Of course, it can be difficult sometimes.
Yeah. No, I love that. I think there's a strong sense of servant leadership within you. Wish we had more time to explore that. When are you going to be back in D.C.?
I believe we are hoping to be back in the States probably towards the end of 2020. But you'll be the first to know.
Love it. Awesome. Man, appreciate you taking some time.
Cheers, brother.
To hang. All right. And follow Greyson Chance on Instagram @GreysonChance to keep up with him and hear about what he's doing. But appreciate the insight, man. It was awesome.
Cheers.